Hello everyone, good evening. Welcome to our monthly online offline for January. First of all, thank you for having ventured through the cold. I know it isn't always that simple, but that's why they got me here, to warm you up again, to welcome you all. First of all, it must be noted that the entrepreneurs are really the headline act of tonight. That's why I'm only, you know, the support act, the one to warm you up. That's also why they got a less handsome and less talented version of Ed Sheeran to sort of bring the warm-up to you. Let's start with the very important stuff, the Wi-Fi access, just in case you wanted to look something up concerning the things I'll be explaining to you or the entrepreneurs that will be talking tonight, or just in case you sort of want to look busy on your phone and not have to talk to your neighbor, which we, of course, do encourage. First of all, the entire My Microinvest team says hello, but also today we say a bit more. We say Happy New Year to you all. I don't know if any of you have made any New Year's resolutions. All of us sincerely hope that your New Year's resolution and your being here means that your New Year's resolution is to invest in promising young Belgian startups. Our New Year's resolution is to keep doing what we did in 2017 because we believe that we are doing something good and that we strive to improve our world by empowering entrepreneurs with our investment crowdfunding platform, and that we simplify, you know, investing, and that we bring an equity class to investors that is usually without outside of the reach of your of the average investor. And that we can simplify the connection between entrepreneurs and investors, not only by means of our online platform, but also by means of events like this here tonight. And how do we do that? We do that by organizing crowdfunding campaigns in which the crowd co-invests with professionals, which gives them the guarantee that there's professionals backing every project, but also gives, you know, these professionals and the company is the opportunity to get the approval, the market approval of the crowd. How do we do that? Well, we first of all would like to sort of differentiate ourselves in the crowdfunding landscape. We are not like the GoFundMes or the Kickstarters of this world in the sense that we offer investment crowdfunding. So here you won't be finding the newest skiing jacket, which offers multiple pockets that you can reserve to get as the first person, but instead you can invest in young, mostly Belgian startups who offer a part of their equity or who have agreed to take on a loan with the crowd on which the in which the crowd can invest from 100 euros onwards. So that means that either the campaigns and the entrepreneurs that you'll hear speak tonight will be offering a part of their shares to the crowds because they believe in the power of the crowds, you know, as a market proof. So investing as of 100 euros, that just popped up there. For those who didn't expect to see, you know, complicated graphs here, maybe here's a moment to snooze out, but this is basically the diagram that explains our financing vehicle, MMI Finance, which allows us to facilitate that relation between entrepreneurs and the crowd, in the sense that we will pool all crowd investors for a certain company, and we will give them equity-linked notes for their investment, which means that you don't get actual shares in the company when you invest through My Microinvest, but you get an equity-linked note, which means, or a debt-linked note, if it's a loan campaign, which means that you get all the economic rights of shareholdership. So if there's any returns, they will be proportionally returned to the investors, but you do not have to burden yourself with, you know, all the presence at general assemblies or delivering proxies for those general assemblies. All those investors will be pooled in what we call a compartment, and that's basically what is connected to every crowdfunding campaign. And in that compartment, we first, of course, pool all the money that is invested. With that money, we invest in shares of the company, or we give a loan to the company. And that means that all those investors are nicely packed into that little compartment there, and all those little compartments, ever since the law of the 28th of December 2016, are hermetically closed off, and so financial mishap in one of the compartments does not negatively impact the other compartments. And of course, we have then the pro-investor who will invest directly into the company and who will take on the role as a sort of a certifier for the crowd, who will guarantee that the valuation of the company is up to standards, but also that the crowd will get the economic rights or the voting rights that are promised to them. So we have also the numbers to back this up. With this structure, we have funded over 85 companies. We have gathered more than 40,000 members and have invested more than 45 million in those companies. And how do we do that? Well, the co-investing with professionals I've already explained you. We're one of the only platforms who can boast that they've already published a prospectus. So for larger campaigns, and that we have, you know, the capability of doing that. And we also have our own venture capital funds with which we closely cooperate to also offer interesting prospects. And what we also can do is we can offer the tax shelter to investors. Ever since the 1st of February 2017, we are a company, company as well, of course, but also a platform that is accredited by the FSMA to deliver the tax incentive of the startup tax shelter to investors who invest through our campaigns. What does that mean? That means that that anyone who invests in a tax shelter company through My Microinvest can benefit from a tax reduction of 30 or 45%, so up to 45%. Now, why has the Belgian government set such a scheme into place? It's basically to stimulate investments in the real economy. So investments in young Belgian companies who make a real contribution to the Belgian economy and who promise to, you know, deliver such benefits to the Belgian economy for the next 4 years. And so basically, this scheme has the purpose of taking all that sleeping money that you all have in your savings account. I'm saying you all have, I'm just assuming, I haven't checked your bank accounts before. But obviously, there's a lot of dormant savings money in Belgium that is stuck in savings accounts and that the Belgian government sort of wants to pry out of your account and get into that real economy and keep it circulating. And they do that by guaranteeing a tax reduction when you invest in such companies. That means that you get 45 or up to 45% of the amount that you invest in a young Belgian company directly back when you file your taxes. Basically, I said all of that. What are young and small companies? There you can see the criteria. Basically, there's two categories or two brackets of tax reduction that are open to investors through My Microinvest, also through direct investments. So an investment in an SME or a KMO for the Dutch speakers entails a tax reduction of 30%, and an investment in a microenterprise delivers you a tax reduction of 45% on your income taxes. The conditions is that you can invest up to 100,000 euros per person per year in this under this tax scheme, which means a net tax reduction of up to 45,000 euros per year. You will get the reduction in the same tax period of the investment in the company. That doesn't mean the moment you invest on the Mail Microinvest website, but the moment that we take the money that was in the little compartment you saw earlier and actually invest it in the company, so have a capital increase in the company. You must show a proof of investment. Well, that's very easy because My Microinvest will provide you with such a certification the moment you need it. And that will all be done online on the platform. And of course, I mentioned the term of 4 years. Since the Belgian government sort of wants to guarantee that the money is used to grow the company and then to establish a real economic activity on the Belgian soil, the shares need to be held for 48 months. If you don't do so, you will have to return part of your tax reduction to the fiscal authorities. We are very much aware that investing in startups is a risky affair. It has no sense in denying that. That's also why the tax shelter was invented, to sort of harness a part of that risk and to make sure that investors who invest in a certain company that then goes bankrupt, that they at least have a certain amount of their money that is protected. And we, as a investment platform, always want to guarantee also that people are diversifying their investments. We, in the past, have tried to say that to people, you know, you should diversify your investments, try to invest in at least 10 companies to, you know, make sure that you beat the market and that you have at least a couple of companies in your portfolio who have a big chance of making it big, of being very successful. But we often encountered people that, you know, found a lot of trouble in actually doing that. And that's why we have developed the Tracers, which is a diversification tool, which basically allows people to subscribe to the next 10 campaigns that will be either tax shelter or in which our InVentures private venture capital fund will invest. And that way you have way less trouble in diversifying your investments and making sure that you sort of hedge your bets on investments through My Microinvest. So this is a tool that basically helps you build that diversified portfolio. And it will help you invest in a certain amount of projects that fit a set of criteria that is set on beforehand. And we've, in the meantime, in 2017, have completed a first successful tracer, in which four investments took place in four young Belgian companies for that amount of money there, well over 250,000 euros, which enabled all investors, the 26 people who invested in that tracer, to deduct at least 45% from their taxes. We will have actually one of those entrepreneurs who received an investment from the tracer here later to direct a little word towards you, no spoilers. So more information about the traces can be found through that link. And if you, you know, take away the traces bit at the end, you can find all the other information that you want about us. So if there's any questions at this point, you can shoot them right at me. And otherwise, I will you know, gladly have the headliners for tonight take the stage.
Sorry.
Yes?
Is there a way to meet the professional during the gathering or on another gathering?
Usually we don't already have the professional investors identified when the campaign goes online. When the campaign closes, the entrepreneurs have 6 months to find these professional investors. So it's not really possible to sort of identify these people on the spot. And also, it's not, well, those are not always people who would like to take the stage and who would, well, sometimes they would rather remain to, or rather remain discreet. So unfortunately not, sorry. Anyone else? Yes?
If you invest in your own company, does the tax shelter apply?
The tax shelter does not apply to people who will take a leading role in their own company, who will be a director of the company. Of course, this doesn't mean that you can't be creative and have a relative invest, but you know, you don't have it from me. That whole level of thing. You haven't heard. Okay, then I'll gladly hand over the mic to Peter.
Thank you, Achirin. Good night, everyone. My name is Peter. I'm also part of the team of My Microinvest. Together with Jonathan, we prepare the entrepreneurs for the campaign. He's doing more the legal side and doing more the financial side. So I'm just going to introduce the entrepreneurs, tell a little bit how the preparation went, who did well and who did not well. No, that's a stupid joke. We have three entrepreneurs tonight. So as Jonathan already said, we have Kiko, who did a campaign end of 2017, who is going to give a small testimonial to show you what it is to do a campaign and how much they raised. So I will give the floor to Emory in a second. And then we have two other entrepreneurs, UpToDate and iBeauty, who will launch a campaign today or the next couple of days and who will pitch their startup. So the format is a pitch of 5 minutes, and then there will be some Q&A afterwards. So, Emily, the floor is yours, and thank you for coming.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Amo from Kiko, and today I'm going to explain you what Kiko is about. Just get a short introduction about our product, our brand, and then I'll share with you my experience, expertise, about raising funds, and raising funds with the team of My Microinvest. Now first, Kiko. Why Kiko? Because every single one of you has felt like this, at least once today. No wonder. You all worked hard today, you even make it to another activity at night, and then you get tired. And we at Kiko, we identified why you get tired. You meet, it crawls up on you from behind, it touches you, and then you feel tired, you start yawning, you might feel a bit grumpy. I bet a lot of you already experienced and encountered the afternoon dip monster before. And what do people in general tend to do when they meet the afternoon dip monster? They drink coffee. Lots of coffee. On average in Belgium, an average consumer drinks 3.8 cups of coffee per day. But we all know that coffee can have some disadvantages. So what are the alternatives? We might turn to tea. But tea has all kinds of different functionalities and it doesn't really bring us the energizing aspect we need. We might drink a soda. But we all know that those are actually sugar bombs. They're not very healthy for you. So we sat together with the team and we asked ourselves a very important question. What else? What else can we drink that gives us an energy boost that's also good for us? You know, we want to stay healthy. We want to be conscious about what we drink, what we eat. And that's why we invented Kiko, a hot, natural energy drink. So it's a drink, it's a powder in a pouch that you dissolve in hot water, based on guarana and mate, two very ancient ingredients from Latin America, being used for centuries and centuries. And we have very good news for you. Kiko is 100% natural and contains 0% sugar. It's a guilt-free consumption. There's no trick. You rip it, you mix it, you drink it, and you feel it. It's in a pouch, it's very convenient, and we sell it to you in a box that fits in your mailbox. You don't need to stay home for it, it just comes via mail, and you have the Kiko box at home. What does it do to you? Well, the effect is actually comparable to a cup of coffee. It's more durable. We all know the nervousness when you have a really strong coffee and then the crash. Well, guaranina, the active ingredient of guarana, is absorbed more slowly in the blood. And so your effect is actually no crash. So that's the product. What are we about as a brand? We want to be a daily source of positive energy. So you already know what Kiko does. It gives you a durable energy boost. But also, on an emotional point of view, we want to be fun. We don't take ourselves too seriously. We just want to bring a smile to your face when you have a Kiko at work, when you share a Kiko with colleagues. And then again, there goes the grumpiness, the tiredness. Be ready to continue the day, do fun things in the day. It's about working harder or working longer. It's about bringing positive energy to the people. How do we do that? We want to be the best pick-me-up during the afternoon dip. We want to, together with you, eradicate the afternoon dip monster. It all creeps up on you around 2-3 p.m. And how do we do that? We want to become a buddy brand. Like I said, we're fun, we don't take ourselves too seriously, neither should all of us. We can all laugh a bit more, especially at work, and that's why we build our brand around these values. Now, enough about the product. What did we do last couple of months? Well, actually, we launched Kiko in December 16, and we had a year of sales, and our repurchase rate was high. Whereas, in general, a corporate, when they launch a beverage, they're happy with a repurchase rate of 30%. After 6 months, our repurchase rate was 60%. So we thought, yeah, we have a good product, we have a good brand. People like to buy Kiko, they like to consume Kiko, they like telling other people about Kiko. We need to take the next step. And that's why, mid-October, we decided to raise funds to actually next year accelerate our growth, grow our team, our investments, and our consumer base. And that's why I'm proud to say that in the last week of December, we closed a €300,000 investment round, half of it by a private investor. We call them the friends of Kiko, people in our network, people we got to know, invested a significant amount of money. The other half via my micro-invest. Part via the crowd, part via the new Tracer tool, that I just talked to you about. And they asked me to share my experiences with my micro-invest and with the Tracer. So I think it was very positive for us. It helped us to raise a large amount of money in a short amount of time. So the Tracer actually really helps you to boost up your crowdfunding rounds. The crowd is super. They're super important. They're ambassadors. And the Tracer actually works like a multiplier because they invest a bit larger sums of money than the crowd. And also the questions you get from Tracer investors are already at a higher level. So they really, really challenge you on your business model, on your brand, on your plans. Are you sure about this? Are you sure about that? That's exactly what you want and what you need when you raise funds. You need people to challenge you to make sure you polish your story and that you're convinced of your ideas and your plans. Now, last one, a tip. I would recommend every startup to first go to the Tracer. They're really gonna polish your business model. They're gonna ask you very, very challenging questions, which is good for you. And then after you've raised the Tracer amount, then go to the crowd and really build your ambassador base. So that's what the crowd is about. It's not only about the investment and the money. So it's actually sending a mail to those people, like we're doing now. Look, thanks for your investment in Kiko. Here are some free Kiko boxes. Go and spread Kiko in the world, because they're co-owner of your company. And that's why we really enjoyed our collaboration with My Microinvest. To end up, if you have any questions, feel free to ask them now. You can also send me a mail. As a treat for you, if you go to drinkkiko.com, you can buy a box at a 50% discount when you use the discount code MMI, so the abbreviation of My Microinvest. Thanks for your attention. Watch out for the afternoon dip, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thank you.
Are there some questions for Anoui?
How much was worth your company before you raised 300,000?
So we looked at it and we built our financial model based on our forecast and so on, and we, our pre-money valuation was 966,000 euros.
So how many shares did you exchange for that 300,000?
Basically, we exchanged approximately 25% of our shares for 300,000 euro investment.
Okay.
That's something also, that valuation, that model, that's something you talk about with your private investors. They're investing a lot of their private money. You go through your financial forecast. How do you come to that valuation? Are you too risk averse? Are you too optimistic? Are you delusional? And actually, we convinced them of our model, of our team, of our brand. They invested their money, and that actually gives you the credibility afterward to go to the crowd and the trace. Look, we discussed this with some very smart people. We had some bankers in our Friends of Kiko, we had entrepreneurship professors, we had people from the industry. They all believed in our product, in our brand, in our valuation. That helps them when you go to the crowd and to the tracers to raise the other part of your fund.
Do you often meet with your co-investor to discuss about that, or do you go to tracer to discuss it?
So it depends. We have, so the private investors are grouped in Friends of Kiko. So they're about 10. And yes, we meet with them. So we're gonna meet them on a regular basis. But as well, we're gonna update our investors as well on a regular basis. So it's not that we meet our private investors in person, but the crowd will be updated on a regular basis. And like we said, they're our ambassadors. So we really wanna keep them close and use them to help actually build our brand and build their company as well, because they're now co-owners.
Thank you.
Maybe important to add is that the crowd always invested the same valuation as the co-investors, so there is no difference there.
I have a question about your process. I mean, what do you start from to produce your tea? Do you grow the plants or do you buy powder and mix it?
So how do we make Kiko?
Mm-hmm.
So we spend we spent a lot of time on research and development. But now our producer sources the ingredients for us, and they're actually producing the product. So we don't touch it, and we're not making every batch individual. I'm going to sip of my beer to answer your other questions. So to summarize, R&D process, you do it yourself. You try to talk to people in the industry, but you try a lot yourself. And then you test it, you actually go out and try selling it. We had a prototype before. Lots of people bought it, nobody bought it again, it was horrible. But people bought it, people wanted an alternative copy. So that gave us first traction. Okay, we need to really build this product, build this brand. And we built the product together with a producer of Kiko. They're actually, we're sending the ingredients to them, or they're sourcing the ingredients, and they package it. They have all the, so we don't need to invest in machinery, in a plant, and so on. Great, lovely, thanks. We own the product, the brand, and yes, we sell the product and the brand. Because I didn't introduce our team, where the three of us are sales and marketing profiles. We have a background in large FMCG corporations. So yes, that's what we're good at. Building, having the drive, but also sales and marketing. I'm not an expert in the production line and so on, so we're outsourcing that process. Thanks for the question.
A question from my side. was it hard work to prepare the crowdfunding campaign and to answer to all the questions of the crowd, of the people from the Tracer? In the end, did you spend a lot of time preparing and running your crowdfunding campaign?
Yes, it's a main activity. So when you do it as a team, you really need to prioritize it, which isn't easy. You want to start up, there's tons of different things to do, because you ask people to invest their own private money. So yes, you need to be reachable, you need to answer their question, you need to embrace it when they challenge you about every aspect of your business. So yes, it is a really big commitment you need to make as a team when you go out and you raise funds, both in the preparation but also in the actual process to really answer their questions and make sure they're investing their own money.
There is still one question that you can take. Maybe then the last one.
Okay, sorry. Have you already managed to attract new people around you or yourself to make sure that once your business starts growing that you have the right resources around you to manage all the workflows?
So you're talking about, the question is related to our team and are we already growing our team?
Yeah.
So I have two magnificent co-founders. We've been friends since childhood. We study together. So there's three of us in the team. Now we're gradually going to expand our team. So I'm going to be the first full-time equivalent as of now. Second one is stepping in June. And then depending on how fast the business goes, then we're going to attract new talent. That's the question. Do you need sales representatives? Do you need people to actually do the digital marketing? First, we need to step in. We need to structurize the business, grow it ourselves, touch every single aspect of the business. And then when you see, okay, we need that profile to do that job, that's when you acquire new people. You hire new people to actually grow. A lot of startups, in my opinion, do the mistake of, okay, fine, we've got money on the bank, we've got our plan, now we need to hire 10 people to execute that. No, that's an all or nothing bet. You need to go in there yourself, you need to grow fast and grow gradually. Because once people are in the company, your burn rate just explodes, actually. You're burning a lot of cash. That's why we're gradually expanding the team. We're going to end 2018 with about 3 full-time equivalents, but I'm the first one now. Thanks.
Are you planning to go in Belgium or elsewhere?
So we're first actually in Belgium. Why? Because we're very close to our consumers. We can ask them questions and so on. And it's a very difficult market to launch a brand. We're in FMCG. We know it's hard to launch a brand here. But then, of course, we wanna grow first to other European cities like Paris, London, Amsterdam, Berlin, and then afterwards conquer the world, which was in our business plan, actually. No, but really, you're laughing, but if Red Bull conquered the world from Austria, why not Tico from Belgium? You don't have to be in the US, you don't have to be in China or Singapore to build a consumer brand. It's possible. So we're going to try to do it first from Belgium, but then everywhere in the world. Thanks.
Good luck with it. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, so we'll move forward to the second pitch of tonight. Maybe first, as an introduction, who of you is going to the hairdresser from time to time? I guess everyone. And who of you thinks that it's very hard to have efficient meetings or not to wait too long at the hairdresser? Someone as well. So this company, iBeauty, is working to solve that problem. So they will help, they have a SaaS, a software as a service, that helps beauty salons and hairdresser salons to be efficient towards their customers. And we will hear Michel in a couple of seconds pitching his startup, which we launched today on the platform as a tech shelter company. So we can invest as of now. Maybe first a small story of how we get in touch with iBeauty, because it's quite funny. In November, there was a Web Summit in Lisbon. It's all around technology and technology startups. And two lucky guys of my microinvest were selected to go, and it was myself plus Sébastien, a colleague. And it's 3 days. So during 3 days, you're meeting a lot of startups. You try to find the diamond in the rough to do a next campaign with. So it's 3 days of networking and of talking to a lot of people. And at the end of the third day, we were a bit tired, and so we were waiting in the queue for lunch. And behind us, we heard some Flemish. So we said, okay, we will give it a shot and approach the people and speak to them. It was at a stand for tacos. And so the two entrepreneurs also took their taco. The four of us had a taco, so we had lunch together and we were talking about their business. And actually they said, yeah, we are thinking of raising money because it's going well, but we really want to accelerate. And so as it was a tech shelter company, it was an interesting talk we had. We said, yeah, why not doing it with my microinvest? And so as we Belgians, we never decide on the spot. We came back to Belgium and we had some more talkings. And then finally, beginning of December, we took the decision to launch a crowdfunding campaign with them. And so I'm very pleased to introduce you to Michel, our first Echo Shelter campaign.
Thank you, Peter. Ladies and gentlemen, this in my hand is a paper agenda. This is what most beauty salons and hairdressers are still using to manage their salon. And when you buy it, it looks like this. It looks very clean, it looks very orderly, but after a few weeks or a few months, it gets very chaotic, it gets full of errors, okay? So what is the big problem with this? In a paper agenda, of course, you have no automation. Paper agenda cannot send out emails, cannot send out reminders via SMS. You have no insights, and you have no trends, you have no patterns. And mostly you have no customer experience because there is no touch point with the customer and the beauty salon. So some time ago, a friend of mine who has a beauty salon, we were doing web design and web development at that time. She asked us to make a very simple client management tool to replace her paper agenda, her manner of working. And that is actually how iBeauty has existed or was born. So we tried to solve everything that is needed to successfully run into business. So let's look at a bit of the solution that we offer. First of all, we have, of course, the agenda that I explained. We have internal agendas, but we also have online reservation tools. That's very important, actually, because a beauty salon, most of them have about 15, 20, or sometimes 25% of no-shows. If you simply mail them or text them the reminder of the appointment, it drops down to 3 to 5%. So that's a major, easy-to-solve problem for beauty salons, which is already worth the full package actually of iBeauty. Something else is, for example, the newsletters. They are very segmented. So most companies, they send out an email to everybody, let's say. But with our built-in newsletter, you can send very targeted newsletters. For example, to people who only bought shampoo A last week, and you can target them very specifically. Maybe the cashier, right? There's also the cashier in the software. And the cashier is very smart because it tells the salon what were the last bought products of some customer who gets into the salon. So it's an easy step to start a discussion or to advise people about the products that they buy, which raises again the selling of the articles. That's our pricing model. Very simply, we have a free version for the people who want to test our software. We are also in 10 schools, 10 beauty schools in Belgium, where every student has a iBeauty license, which is free, of course, for them. And then for the commercial salons, we have two paying versions. That's our monthly recurring price that they have to pay to rent the software. Our market, of course, the iBeauty and the hairdresser market is a very big one. Everybody goes to the hairdresser, not me. But for example, in Belgium, we have about 8,000 beauty salons and about 20,000 hairdressers, which, as you can see, if we would raise or if we could convince everybody to use iBeauty, we have pretty big recurring revenues only for a small country like Now, iBeauty is not an idea, it's a running company. And as we are a SaaS company, these are very, very important numbers in our type of business model. Compared 2016 to 2017, we We have kind of doubled our paying customers. But more importantly, are these two, it's the customer lifetime value and the churn. It's, churn is the amount of people that cancel their subscription. So in a year, we have kind of tripled our customer lifetime value, which is, of course, related to a very low churn of 0.7%, where the average in the industry is about 6%. So we have been able to decrease the churn very much, which gives us a very high customer lifetime. Very important numbers for our type of business. We are not alone. We have two main competitors, Salonized, which is a Dutch company focusing on beauty, and Optios, which is a Belgian company focusing on the hairdresser market. And now in 2018 and coming, we would like to go much further. Okay. You see our middle layer, we have the salons using our software. But on top of that, we have the suppliers providing all the cosmetic articles. And we also have the customer at the bottom who go to the salon and buy the products. So our goal is to create extra digital tools to optimize the full circle, actually, of the beauty process. That's why we need you. That's why we are raising capital to make this possible. So our business model will change or will expand from a recurring revenue paid by all the salons who are using the software. We will create a portal, something like booking.com, but for the end customers of beauty salons. And then the article database is actually an assets manager for cosmetic products, where they can manage their products that are sold to the salons which were sold. So we'd like to develop systems to close the circle, actually, of the process. This is very shortly our business plan, which month or which quarter we would like to realize the specific steps of our plan. And I'm not alone. I have my fantastic partner, Frederik, where we raised the company in October 2016. So we are the founders of the company. We have Marie-Laure, who does most of the customer service. She gives demos, she gives training to the people. She tests the software. Then we have Zanel, who is just like Marie-Laure, fully employed by us. And then we have Jan, who is our freelance technical advisor for the development of the tool. So I know I had only 5 minutes. I hope I'm not spending too much. So if you have any questions about my pitch, I would like to answer your questions. Thank you.
Are there some questions?
Yes, I would like to know what is your plan for marketing in Broadline, of course. And secondly, you mentioned only a couple of Belgian companies competitor. Are you sure that other international competitors are not going to bother you?
Okay. The first question about the marketing. We think there are two main paths that we have to go through, which is the normal one, which would be the online marketing, Facebook, Instagram, where our typical salon is present. But I think the main or the best reason to scale very fast is to use the network of the existing cosmetic partners. So for example, we are talking with there's actually a customer who uses iBeauty, who has a salon here in Brussels, and they are also the distributor of an American company who sell pigments for permanent makeup. So our customer, she likes iBeauty very much, and she has confidence in our as a team and in the company. So she pushed iBeauty to the American company, and they would like to use iBeauty as a white label software to spread over more than 70 distributors in the whole world. So that's just an example of how fast it actually could go if we use the existing network of existing cosmetic partners. And slide about the competition. There are more competitors, that's true. We have international competitors. A very big one is Mindbody, who is the top competitor, but they stay in the States. It's a very, very big company, but we never hear them when we are at the salon. The two people that we hear are mainly Salonized and Optios, and there are maybe five more that we kind of sometimes hear, but we feel that we are very able to get the full market with these three, with Ali, Salonized, Optios, and IBT as the three major suppliers. But these are the two most important competitors.
Can you maybe just say what is your competitive advantage compared to the competitors?
Yeah. For Salonized, I will make a feature example. We have our integrated newsletter, like I said, where you can target very specifically a specific part of your customers, which is very nice because it goes much more smoothly than using another external package. Yeah, Salonized is using MailChimp, which is a perfect mailing software. But the thing is, you have to export a client list, you have to get into MailChimp to set up everything. In our case, everything is already integrated and set up. For Optios, that's a little bit more difficult to say because we're not here, Ali, we're here to promote us, not to say something about Optios, but we feel that there are a lot of customers willing to change to another software because of some problems that they experience with that software. So we feel that it's a very a good way to go.
Easy question, maybe hard to answer. Why do you need the money from the fundraising?
Yeah, we need the money to scale faster. That's the main reason. We grow every month, but we grow steadily and in a line, let's say. And we feel that it's now the moment to go faster, to scale, and to conquer the market. And we cannot do that without extra money.
Yeah, my question was a bit more precise. How do you plan to scale up based on using that money?
What will we do with the money, you mean? Okay. It's to do marketing, like the question of Mr. here. It's to do marketing and it's to use the partners of the existing network of the partners. But of course, all these partners have to be contacted, have to be worked on, and it takes time, and we can buy time by getting more people, getting a bigger team to do this. And that's not free. But the main reason is scaling much faster. Yeah, instead of growing organically, we want to have the curve in our revenue graph. Is that?
Yes, thank you.
I've got two questions. So the software is mainly working on installed customers.
Your first question, I didn't.
If I understand it well, it's mainly working now on installed customer base. How will does it help, or can it help salons to attract new customers? Not only you're saying not want to work on partners, but also on new customers.
How can salons use our software to attract more customers?
Yeah. Okay. New customers.
New customers. That would be mainly via the online reservation module. Because they can put it on their website, they can put it on their Facebook page. But to make that much easier, it would be nice if we could create this portal, this marketplace of beauty salons. So like this, we can have a like booking.com,
but for Pubisons. As the software exists now, it's mainly to manage the day-to-day working of a Pubisons. And concerning the GDPR, we are very aware of that because we are doing nothing but keeping personal data. We provide the software, but it's actually the salon who keeps the data or who is gathering the data using our software. So it's kind of a double system. Our solution would be that the end customer of the salon can have access to their personal client file, let's say, where she can access or define, I would like to receive email, I would like to receive a reminder, I would like to remove all my data, which is also needed by GDPR. So we would like to give the power to the end customer to decide what is being done with her personal data. That would be the best, I think, the best solution for us.
Yeah. Any more questions? Yeah, I was wondering if you could go back to the slide with a different functionality and consider to manage your actual customers in order to provide extra services, not only calendar management, but also sharing of best practices or sharing of experience from certain suppliers, or maybe also managing the community of clients for those customers, so that they that the other clients can see feedback from how it went in that beauty salon, that sort of thing.
Yeah, we every year. It's only the third time we organize this because we're pretty new. We have a beauty boost camp, like we say. It's on three locations in Belgium, and we invite all our customers or potential customers to that evening. We invite somebody who comes to talk about who comes to talk about the product, and somebody else who comes to talk about management or dealing with stress, and also we have a kind of small debate where all the salons who are coming to the beauty boost camp can discuss about products, etc. But that's on a scale to one or a few times per year. But do you mean like setting up a digital community?
Yeah, and also trying to manage the representation of the members of IQT in every geographical area, in every commune or in every city, so that there is no intercompetition between the same hairdressers in the same city or something like that. So that you actually manage the community all over a region.
I don't think I get the question very clearly. Do you mean like setting up a kind of user group?
A user group, yeah. So that they don't fear the competition from a neighbor hairdresser, but they're willing to share experiences on practices or on the latest trends.
Yeah, but coming together.
Coming together, yeah.
Well, I think that would be the best way is to expand those beauty boost camps that you are organizing now, then maybe better on smaller scales and more frequently to come together much more often.
But you could go even further and imagine some sort of a Facebook-like application where the community of addresses share things amongst.
Yeah, we could set up a private user group on Facebook. That could be possible.
Last two questions that I may. One is credibility questions. So I understand you're neither in the beauty industry yourself, nor I think a woman, which I think is the majority, probably not of the hairdressers, but maybe of the beauty salon. So is that an issue, or has it ever been an issue? And second question is, you're looking to scale. What in your assessment is the biggest risk you're going to face?
The first part. The first part is we are now in Belgium. Yeah, we have only Belgian salons, a few dozen.
Dutch people, a few from Luxembourg. But we visit almost every customer. Okay, it's very expensive, yeah? But it's very, very, very useful because we sit next to the people, we see how they work with the software. For example, if you come to a salon for a demo and you have to wait a few minutes because she's dealing with the last customer, it's very, very interesting to see when she goes to the screen, she starts up IBT, she says to the customer, when do you want to come? I click on my agenda, I click next week, I click this date. And it's very interesting for us to see how they use the software. And that way we are not beauty specialists, that's true, but we learn very, very much. And I think by now we can say that we know everything about what they need or what their problem is in the salon. The second question was about scaling.
Yeah, what's the biggest risk?
The biggest risk in scaling. That's a good question. Frederik, do you know what the risk would be?
Yes, I'll stand up. Maybe just to go a bit further on your question, I think it's very important to know that the typical client from us, they are passionate people. They are people who are really busy with their job. They're very good at it also. It's something we don't need to know how they do it because they're the best. They're almost like artists. Where do we step in? It's because what they do is an activity, but they also have a business. And that part is often forgotten. Not because they don't want to do it, but because it's a little bit, it's out of their real passion. And so where we step in is try to optimize that for them so that it's something they don't need to think about. And that's a very good marriage together. The other question, the risk. Of course, we have some elements that are uncertainties that we are faced with. But what we focus on is the confirmations we've had till here. So we know that there is a demand. We see what are the things that need to be done. The money will be spent, as Michelle mentioned, on very logical things. So the human power to develop the things with which we will enable or which should enable us to make scaling. People, good people. I think that's the most important one. And second of all, of course, like the gentleman mentioned, the marketing to roll it out. The risk, technically there could be the risk that the hairdresser market is a little bit different from the beauty market. Could be a risk. But in the meantime, also that we have covered because we see that more and more people are starting to use our software as a hairdresser. And the reason why we didn't tackle that market yet was because the agenda is different. So the beauty salon has a very simplified agenda. It's a one-off method. A hairdresser has a split agenda. That means that somebody can come in for one activity, then sits under a machine for 20 minutes, which is actually not a personal activity. So that person can do something else. And after 20 minutes, a third person will take over to cut the hair, after which there's another activity done by a hair dryer. So this is a very complex thing. And that is something we are now in the final stage. And once we have that ready, I would say by the end of January, we're now testing it, but now it will go live. Our market will go from 8,000 potential in Belgium to 28,000. So that is the big jump we are hoping for. Internationalization is then the next step, depending how much funding we will have to attack it. I hope I answered the question. Thank you.
As a wrap-up, I think it's very brave that two bold-headed men try to attack that market. So big applause for Frederik and Michel. Okay, so that brings us to the third and last pitch of tonight. And I'm going again to ask you some questions, obviously. So, who of you is member of an association, like a sport club or youth organization? Quite a lot of people. And who of you is also responsible for the communication there and needs to communicate to members of that group? So, a couple of potential clients, you see? UpToDate is an instant messaging platform specifically targeted for associations. So what do they do? They will explain it in a minute. But in short, they help associations in reaching their members, not through omni-channels like Facebook Messenger and all the like, but through a dedicated channel in which everyone involved in the association find its way. The campaign is not online yet. It's also a text shelter campaign, but will be put online in the course of the week, and you will, as one of the first, receive the link, so you will also be able to invest as one of the first in this company. So, Bert and Yuri, the floor is yours, and thank you very much.
Hi, so I'm Bart. For many years, I've been volunteering in a couple of associations, not only as a board member, but also as a trainer or a coach. And after a few years, I've noticed something. It's that the fact that in a world where this little communication toy is taking control over our lives, there is still a need and a lack of a better internal communication and also better management within these organizations. So UpToDate wants to guide those organizations in taking the digital step in a human way. Let's focus on the real problem. Well, currently many organizations are struggling to reach their members in an efficient way. They have to use a mix of tools. They have an own website, they use Facebook, they use different chat groups, emails, and other social media. And they use all these channels at the same time to send the same message and to try to reach the same audience. And using all these different tools requires a lot of time and energy from your volunteers. And the fact that they don't know which member uses what social media is getting the volunteers frustrated. And also having to answer the same question over and over again, like, when is the game tomorrow? When do we have to be there? Well, the fact that you have to answer that over and over again, after a while, you get demotivated. And when your volunteers get demotivated, then your organization is really at risk. What is our solution? Well, we offer a free, no-nonsense mobile communication platform for every kind of organization. When the organization can inform and update their members on calendar events, news messages, photo messages, they can add attachments and also geolinks. UpToDate users can follow multiple organizations at the same time within the same app. So you are not aware of your next cycling race with your cycling club, but you're also updated about the next soccer game of your little son or the next dance competition of your little daughter. We also created a brand new way to attract club sponsors. And in fact, there is also an in-app payment where members can pay the membership fees, which occur yearly, and also event subscription fees via the platform. Our go-to-market is based on the basic free and premium paid principle. For the basic free version, which is already available, we aim for sport associations, culture associations, youth movements, and event organizers. For those type of organizations, club sponsoring is key to survive. And UpToDate, we invented this type of sponsorship, and it will allow us to generate revenue even from the free version. For the premium paid version, which is not online yet, we focus more on business clients, like overarching organizations, federations, cities, schools, rest homes, home care organizations, freelance pools, and so on. And for these type of organizations, we count on the importance of premium support, but also some additional premium features that will be present in this version. For the premium version, as well as for the free version, we know that the market is huge. For example, in Flanders only, there are already above 100,000 associations like sports clubs and youth movements. For the premium paid version, it's the same thing. So we think big, but we will start small here in Belgium. But as we know that in all countries, there is a need and a place for UpToDate, because we also went to Web Summit last year, where we could speak to people of over 40 countries. We had a booth there, in fact, and they ensured us that there is a need for UpToDate in every country. So we have to scale fast. Here are some milestones of UpToDate. So in the first half of last year, we were able to release the free version, and then we asked some associations of different type to serve as a pilot. We asked sports organization, youth movement, and culture association to test and use our platform. And in October 2017, we started our roadshow in West Flanders. And after the first roadshow presentation, we already noticed that the number of organizations and the number of users for UpToDate quickly rised. So we now have our agenda fully booked with roadshows in the rest of West Flanders, and we hope to do more next year. And in fact, by the end of next year, we hope to have 1,000 organizations on board in the free version. And by the end of 2019, we would like to have 5,000 organizations on board, which would make us break even. Who is doing all that? Well, the team consists out of two founders, myself and my best friend Yuri, who is also present tonight. We know each other for a very long time, since childhood, and we have the same dream. And because of our compatible IT and technology skills, we were able to work efficiently together with U2U, which is a company based in Brussels, to do our the development of our platform together with us. We were also selected by Microsoft to join the BizPark startup program, so we had some support for the backend and the cloud. And the people of More Stevens are guiding us in the world of startups, which is not simple. And then we also have contacts with BrandQuadergy, who is a Belgian-based company, but internationally located. And they have, in fact, they are ready to get our brand into the world. But to be able to scale up and to be able to develop our premium version, we need also to extend our internal team. So we need an additional mobile developer and also an additional business developer. And that's why we are here tonight to raise funds via my microinvest to be able to do that. So now that you are up to date, I would like to thank you and ask if there are any questions.
First question then from my side directly to jump in what you said. How much do you want to raise? And next to hiring people, what are you going to do with it? You are talking about internationalization. How many countries can you do with this 250,000 euros? Oh, already gave the answer.
In fact, the first amount that we want to raise, indeed the 250,000, is not really to go international. We first want to develop our premium version, because the paid premium version will allow us to make our free version grow, because the organizations that start using the free version, they need a while to work with the tool, to convince their own club sponsors to invest in the club, to activate a club sponsor. And of course, the money will also be used to because we need to follow up the organizations. We need to do the roadshow in several countries. The big advantage of that is that in these events, a lot of organizations of the same type are gathered. Like we went to Birnam, a small city in Flanders, but there were almost 80 organizations present at that event. And so we could do our story to immediately 80 organizations. And if they all invite their members and on the platform, then we have immediately thousands of users. So that's a bit scale. So we need in fact people to do the presentations, to do the follow up, and also to further develop our tool.
Are there any more questions?
So the premium model is your revenue. That's where you're going to get.
Yes.
And so what do you anticipate in terms of numbers and what pricing? Because I assume a lot of associations don't have a lot of money.
I will first answer the question for associations, because associations, even small sports clubs, indeed they don't have money, but we kind of reinvented the club sponsorship. So instead of having all the billboards around the football field or the little paper on the wall in the canteen, we now give the possibility to the clubs to activate their own sponsors at the top of the app, at the top of the mobile app. And in fact, they can go to their sponsor and ask any amount, but they only have to pay us 50 euros a year to activate one sponsor. That is it's not much, but we don't want to forget also the small clubs. So I know that for the big football clubs, for example, this 50 euro is peanuts, but even for small clubs, it can be of high value, because now, with the fact that the sponsors can change their message and in this little advertising every day, in fact, they can also go to a local grocery store, a local bakery, and ask them to sponsor their club, and then the bakery can say, okay, this weekend we have 4 croissants and 1 for free, and then the next week something else, sport shops, for example, can also invest or activate a sponsor banner for a club, and they can just at the start of the new football season, they can say, okay, I'm 25% on that brand. So, and I know that for a lot of clubs, a lot of organizations, sponsors are always the parent of this member or the wife of that member. So they mostly do it in kind of, goodwill. But with this, they can actually go to a possible new sponsor, and they can come with a story. They can convince new and attract new sponsors with that, which is much more efficient than a paper in the canteen or a billboard around the field. Because if you ask your members in your organization, please name me 6 sponsors that are around the field, I'm not sure that the half of your members will be able to answer that question. So there's also a revenue from the free version. And the amounts for the premium paid version go up from 9 euros until 25 just per month, depending on the number of users and then also the storage and so on. So there are quite some parameters.
Then the last question, you launched end of 2017 with a couple of pilot associations. Do you have any feedback already on the usage of the app? How many, like in percentages of the members, use the app on a weekly or monthly basis?
So the sport club is actually using it most. Why? Because they have different groups, age groups, and every team has a competition every weekend. So they have a lot of events. They have a lot of coaches who want to inform their members about the game. The Potter Association, who is a musician organization, they have less events, so for them it's a bit less. But we know that they reach almost all the members with the tool. So we have a good average on the feedback from the users. So it depends on the kind of the type of organization, in fact.
But from the customer base you have today, do you already have some statistics on, unique users a day that log in and try to read or the messages on the screen?
It's a difficult question because I'm not always looking at every single organization and follow them up. But I can tell you that per organization, I think they post by average, one message every 2 days, and a lot of events, of course, every week there are 20, 30 events popping up. But then again, it depends on the type of organization.
Yeah. But maybe I misexpressed myself. It's about the people who are using the app. I just downloaded it. It looks very attractive. So I'm now trying to propose it to my association. How many of those individuals download the app and use it on a daily basis?
Okay, that's a good question indeed. In fact, what we offer the organization is to invite all their members at once via an upload of an Excel file, and then their users are already in the database and connected to that organization. And then the user gets an email and with that email, he is informed that his organization is now using up to date to spread out the communication, and then the users they install the app. But they are already connected, and there is always a fallback in the app to send out the message also via email. And even if they don't install the app, they are already reached via email. But of course, the goal is for the organization to say, okay, we stop using all those different social media and so on, and we use from now on UpToDate as an official communication platform. we don't say that there won't be any chat groups anymore because they will continue to exist, but the official information will always be put on up to date and also always ready to find an up to date. Because if you now have to look into your emails on an event that is going to happen and you received the email 3 weeks ago, nobody will, I mean, at least most of the people won't find it back easily. Same thing for news messages and so on. And up to date, it's a no-nonsense platform. So as a user, you cannot you cannot react on every message that is appearing. You can read it. And if you want to answer, in fact, then the organization has to put a predefined feedback. He has to say, okay, we put something on up to date, and we want the user to answer this or that. And that's it. Then within the message, there are two buttons popping up with the answers, and user can answer the message. So it's a no-nonsense platform, which means there is less noise, noise info appearing in the app. And so for the users or for the members of the organization, it's easy to use. They know if we open it, we find relevant information. So in fact, the organization has to force his members to use up-to-date from now on, because if they don't use it, they won't find the info anymore. So that's also our strength. We count on the organizations to activate all the members because they benefit from it.
I suggest that we will terminate the Q&A session here. If there are some more questions for the entrepreneur, there is obviously the bar now. But first of all, big thanks to and congratulations. That's it for tonight. We still have a drink for you at the bar. Entrepreneurs will also be here, some employees of Amacronist as well. Please come to us if you have some questions. And thank you very much for your presence. Hope you had a good night.